Over. My name is Susanna Swallow. I'm with the USGS in Bozeman, Montana. Today we have the Crown of the Continent Landscape Analysis Ecological Indicators Project, and we're going to start off with Erin Sexton, who will introduce her colleagues. Erin, if you'd like to go ahead.
Yeah, great. Okay, thank you very much, Susanna, and thanks to everybody who is joining us here today and taking the time to watch and participate in the webinar. My name is Erin Sexton. I am a research scientist at the University of Montana Flathead Lake Biological Station and a steering committee member of the Crown Managers Partnership, and I'm also the project lead for the project we're going to talk to you about today. This is just an overview of our presentation. I've introduced myself. You can see the rest of the team here that's on the phone with us. Greg McDermid from the University of Calgary Geography Department will be giving us an overview of the geospatial aspect of this project and the monitoring framework. Tracy Timmons, also with the University of Calgary, will be discussing our transboundary data inventory and integration work. We also have Guillermo Castilla with the University of Calgary, who will give us a case study on our land cover analysis. And then our data manager, Laura O'Gann with the National Park Service Rocky Mountain Inventory and Monitoring Network, will wrap us up. So I'm going to start with the Crown Managers Partnership. The Crown Managers Partnership came into being in 2001, it's 23 agencies with mandates, with environmental management and resource management mandates around the Crown of the Continent ecosystem. And the Crown of the Continent ecosystem is a roughly 18 million acre ecosystem that covers two provinces, British Columbia and Alberta, and the state of Montana, as well as, of course, Canada and the United States. And the managers came together basically with a vision of exploring ecosystem or ecoregional-based ways to collaborate on shared environmental issues in the Crown of the Continent. We operate under the philosophy that the environment doesn't recognize jurisdictional boundaries, and that in order to overcome the restrictions of the jurisdictional boundaries, that we need to be able to cooperate in stewardship in a world of shared resources. And we have the Waterton Glacier International Peace Park at the heart of the Crown of the Continent ecosystem, which was put in place because Canadians and Americans have an interest in operating in peace and goodwill with each other. The Crown Managers Partnership just completed updating our five-year strategic plan. We have a vision for an ecologically healthy Crown of the Continent ecosystem and our mission to collectively develop defined measures of ecological health, the adaptive capacity to meet them across borders, amongst jurisdictions, and with stakeholders by the end of the decade. And this is really the impetus for developing the project that you'll be hearing in this webinar today. Over the last several years, the Crown Managers Partnership has gone through a process of developing six indicators of ecological health that we feel will help us track sort of ecological integrity over time in the Crown of the Continent ecosystem. Originally, we had attempted to sort of come at these individually. So how do you monitor biodiversity at the scale of the Crown of the Continent ecosystem? How do you do water quality or exotic or invasive species? And about 2 years ago, 2.5 years ago, we took a step back and decided to approach our ecological health project from the landscape analysis perspective, because the ecosystem is so large and so jurisdictionally complex, we determined to use our landscape analysis to also get at the other indicators. And so that's the focus of what you'll hear today. So just to give you some perspective, this is how the Crown of the Continent ecosystem fits within the greater Great Northern Landscape Conservation Cooperative region. And really, because, as you can see, we cross state, provincial, and international boundaries, the Crown Managers Partnership can be somewhat of a case study for how the Great Northern LCC might approach some of these multi-jurisdictional analyses in terms of data sharing and data management and data integration across boundaries. This just shows you sort of the jurisdictional complexity in the Crown of the Continent ecosystem. We have many agencies, federal and state and provincial, operating on the landscape, as well as tribes and First Nations. And then, of course, private land, municipalities, all the way down to the smallest level of landscape. And this is really the challenge that we face in trying to rise above the jurisdictions within the ecosystem and manage at a landscape level. And this just shows we have many iconic species within the Crown of the Continent ecosystem, one of which is the grizzly bear, and that many of the species that live within the region do not recognize the jurisdictional boundaries and roam freely around the landscape. And a bear in southwest Alberta has a different management regime than it does in southeast British Columbia versus in Glacier National Park or the Five National Forest of Montana. So here's our approach to our landscape analysis. Basically, our phase one, we began, initiated in 2009, late 2009, early 2010. And what we were looking to do was acquire the freely available GIS data across the scale of the Crown of the Continent ecosystem for specific metrics. And Tracy's going to talk more about this, so I'm just giving a quick overview. But our phase one was basically to assemble the common transboundary geospatial data set. And then from there, catalog those, inventory them, and then prioritize the critical data gaps or inconsistent data that it was necessary for us to fix or fill in order to be able to accurately analyze, conduct analysis of the data, and ultimately do trend monitoring over time at the scale of the Crown of the Continent ecosystem. And then the second phase of this project is to make inferences or correlations between what we see with our landscape analysis and landscape connectivity, our trend monitoring, and the rest of our ecological health indicators. And some of the components of this are to inventory the resource condition at the scale of the Crown of the Continent. We are including a quantitative accuracy assessment for our data, a sensitivity or uncertainty analysis, which will allow us to actually measure how errors are propagated as the data is integrated and synthesized. And then ultimately, we'd like to look at habitat and connectivity analysis across the scale of the Crown. And then the final phase, the final outcome for this project is to be able to, for our partners with the University of Calgary, the National Park Service, Inventory and Monitoring Network, and the University of Montana, to be able to provide knowledge and science information projects to our managers so that they can identify targets and thresholds and environmental outcomes at the scale of the Crown of the Continent ecosystem and ultimately sort of overcome those jurisdictional boundaries. This is our partnership. As I mentioned, we have the Crown Managers Partnership Steering Committee, the National Park Service, Rocky Mountain Inventory and Monitoring Network, University of Calgary Department of Geography, and the Great Northern Landscape Conservation Cooperative. And then these are just the members. Most of us are on the phone here today, just the members of our team that work on this project. And now I'm going to turn the presentation over to Greg McDermid at the University of Calgary Geography Department.
Okay, Greg, you should be presenter now. And if you
I hope everybody can hear me.
We can hear you. Perfect.
Excellent. Stand by for a sec. Might be able to tell this is my first webinar. Okay. So as Erin mentioned, I'm Greg McDermid. I'm an associate professor here in the Department of Geography at the University of Calgary. I kind of feel like my role here in this presentation is provide a little bit more of a philosophical overview of what we're trying to accomplish with this project. I think I'll start by talking about a sort of a concept that I think about a lot, actually, when I'm involved in these sort of multidisciplinary collaborations, especially when they involve people from, you know, science and then other people who work in the management realm. And this is the transformation of data to wisdom. Data being, I mean, I'll describe all these terms and define them as we go through, but if data are sort of raw facts about the world, they're not particularly useful to people outside of those who've collected them. So the first thing we do with data is we organize it into information. So information is simply data that's been assembled and prepared for a particular use, and therefore has got higher quality. What we want to do next is often analyze that information into what I would call knowledge. And so this is information that's got some sort of context, evidence behind it, so that it can be more broadly accepted and understood by other people outside of maybe those who produce the information. Ultimately, what we want to do with knowledge is to make informed decisions. In this case, we want to make informed management decisions at the scale of the crown. So I wanted to introduce these concepts at the beginning because really what we're talking about in this project is being very careful about the way we handle data and produce information so that those people later on who want to use that knowledge to make management can do it effectively and with confidence. Now, I think that geospatial information plays a large role in modern management and science, especially when we're dealing with regional scales. I mean, geospatial information is the way that we portray our environment in a computer system. And like I say, it is the foundation for a lot of these higher level knowledge products that we ultimately want to work with. So I'm looking here at a road network, and I sort of know the history of this. I mean, it's essentially a data set put together. And in this case, you're looking at it as a nice map. But we might use the same road network to, you know, do some sort of management action. Perhaps we'd make a road density surface. Might use to decide whether new developments might be going on to protect people, for example. So this is an important transformation. I'm going to give you an example of what happens to data and how we use it in this sort of management situation. Erin mentioned that we do have a number of iconic species at the crown of the continent. One she mentioned in particular was the grizzly bear. And very often what we want to do as managers is to try and assess where are grizzly bears on the land. This is basically a science problem, and the way that it's done these days is by capturing a representative number of bears on the landscape, putting GPS collars on them, and then the GPS collars sort of wake up periodically during the day, record the exact points on the landscape where the bear is located. This is excellent data, but not that meaningful to people further on down the information hierarchy. So what we need to do is analyze that data into usable information. The way it's done, and some of you on the call might be very familiar with the strategy, we often take those bear use points inside of a GIS and we compare them to the available locations that the bear chose not to use. And then we try and assemble a series of geospatial data sets that might help us explain why the bear chose to live in the place that it did. And again, these are GIS data. This is geospatial stuff. We might use land cover data or some vegetation structure. Maybe we might be interested in roads and human patterns. But essentially what we do is we take all of this information, we do some fancy regression modeling, and produce what we call a probability of occurrence or resource selection. You might be very familiar with this. If you're not, don't be too concerned, because in the end what you get is a very nice looking map. And this map is sort of something that's a little bit more accessible. This is now information that tells people where on the landscape, and in this case we're looking at the home range of a single female grizzly bear, where in the landscape is that bear more or less likely to be found. You can see that as we distill this data, the information becomes more and more valuable. We could go even further and produce very powerful representations of grizzly bear habitat across a region. So again, we've distilled things even further, and now a manager might take this, say, for example, well, now we're looking at a representation of where we have critical habitat on the landscape, or maybe less critical habitat. And we might make management decisions, say, perhaps we need to close this road, this red stripe here that runs right through primary bear habitat. Or we might want to do some remediation over here where there's less critical habitat. In any case, this is the process that we're trying to enhance across the scale of the ground. Tracy described our team a little bit at the beginning. Essentially, we are geospatial experts. We're remote sensors and GIS people who've got some experience with this sort of collaborative work, and we're trying to make this type of activity easier to do at the scale of the Crown and help out the researchers and managers working here. So basically, the message I'm going to deliver here is we need accurate and consistent multi-jurisdictional information, particularly at a place like the Crown of the Continent, where we have a variety of different things going on, a variety of different jurisdictions. And some people on this call may be familiar with the challenges of just taking something simple, like compiling a road database for the various organizations and trying to put it together. And it does not look pretty when you first start. This dog's breakfast we're seeing here on the right is sort of the first cut that you would get after just basically compiling database various. Believe there's a lot of work to be done here before this becomes usable to people. And we do require high-quality map products. They need consistent, they need to be reliable, and they need to be up-to-date. Otherwise, errors in the base products will propagate all the way through that chain I described at the beginning, and we might be making management decisions that are incorrect because of problems with the data. I've been involved in this type of activity for a while, and the team that you were dealing with here, again, has got a lot of experience with this. And the one thing I've noticed is that very often there's sort of a challenge of communicating as we work our way along this chain, especially when we're talking about knowledge formulation and applied science. I'm not sure exactly where it happens. I think it's somewhere here between, you know, the transformation of information to knowledge. And my interpretation for that is that the reason is because, you know, here at the top end, this is largely scientific activity. These are normally researchers who concern themselves with transforming low-level data into usable information. But then they kind of hand it over afterwards to resource managers and regulators who need this knowledge in order to make their management decisions. And believe me, we have a hard time talking across this line. This is a very challenging thing to do, and I've been amazed at the way that we can misunderstand each other as we look across this gulf. I'm also concerned with the way inaccuracies or problems with the data might cascade its way up if people don't understand what's going on either side of the line. I'm going to relate a very quick story that really drove this point home to me recently. I was at a conference this winter where we were talking about grizzly bear habitat mapping. So it's very similar to the example I described below, where we took low-level data, we turned it into habitat maps, and then a further analysis was done to sort of try and understand the way grizzly bear ecology worked out. I won't give you the details of the presentation, but essentially, the speaker at the end of his talk said, and the most amazing thing that we found was that in our study area, male grizzly bears were displacing female grizzly bears with cubs into really secondary habitat, like tree wetlands and swamps. And everybody was like, oh my goodness, that's an amazing piece of knowledge that's been discovered from this work. Now, I was part of the production of lower level information, and I know that the geospatial data products that we provided had some errors associated with them. And in particular, we confused treed wetlands with mixed forth. There was a problem with the data. Yet the people who did the analysis behind me failed to recognize this documented error that we had found. And so instead of actually seeing a real ecological signal, what they were seeing was a problem with the data. But I promise you that that issue, crossing that line from information to knowledge and then later to management, is a difficult one to do. And this is one of the things that we're very concerned with in this project. This challenge of communication, this is another favorite slide of mine. Very often, this is a collaborative exercise between a resource manager and a geospatial specialist, or in this case, a remote sensing specialist. Often we'll come together to sort of collaborate on things that we care about, in this case, scale of account. And the conversation often goes like this. The resource manager will say on from his side of the table, look, you know, we have many resource management, resource information needs. What can you give us with remote sensing? And the remote sensing specialist will say, well, we can give you all kinds of different information. Our tools are very powerful. What are your needs? And the manager says, well, I told you, we have lots of needs. What can you give us? And around and around we go. It's a very frustrating conversation to be part of. And again, it's possible that some of the people on the phone here have been part of this conversation as well. So we've got some experience with this, and I think that what we're trying to do is provide some clarity. So in terms of very general project objectives, this is what we're trying to do. I mean, Erin has provided a more detailed description of what we're doing with phases and whatnot. But my perspective is a little bit more general. I mean, we're trying to break out of this information needs definition circle so that we can support researchers and managers who are working at the crown of the continent. In particular, we're trying to do things that are, you know, cross-boundary at the broad scale. So in order to do this, we need to compile the existing transboundary information. And what you'll see is that when this stuff has problems, which we will document, we will then leverage technology and the remote sensing technology to improve our information products. The second thing we want to do is we want to create a monitoring framework so that as we go through this procedure of compiling and then improving information, we want to do it on a consistent, regular basis so that people working with us can be assured that, you know, every year or every 5 years, there's going to be new data, and it's going to make their job easier. So if they're working with our baseline information, then it'll make their job of producing, you know, knowledge and wisdom that much more. I probably could spend the entire hour describing the monitoring strategy. I'm going to constrain myself, though, and just say a few very basic things. Essentially, what we're trying to do when we're monitoring with geospatial data is the first thing is that we need to establish baseline data. We want to pick a year and say, let's compile all the information we have across our study area for that given year. This is a multi-step process that I won't go into the details with. Some of my later co-presenters will be describing this a little bit. But first of all, we need to assemble the pre-existing data. We're not going to reinvent the wheel if someone has already done the work for us. The second thing we often do is then do some sort of quality assessment or an accuracy assessment to see whether the data suits our needs, and then we'll make some strategic improvements if necessary to fix them. That's all establishing baseline data. That's all my point number one. The second step in our general monitoring strategy is detect changes to the baseline. So we then want to take our baseline year and look forward in time to see what's changed between then and now. And that's essentially a change detection strategy that, again, Guillermo, one of my colleagues, will be describing a little bit later. Detect changes to the baseline. Sometimes that's changes that we get from other organizations. Sometimes that's changes we get through remote sensing. But that's a very specific step, standalone step, detect the change. And then we want to integrate those changes into the baseline to produce an updated baseline. Again, this is a very general overview. I could spend the whole hour describing the details of it, but I just wanted to get a few of these philosophical things out in the open, sort of the beginning of this talk, so that when we move to the next presenter, which will be Tracy Timmons, I mean, it's in a little bit of context. But Tracy's going to speak next about some of the initial activities with, you know, transboundary data integration, so collecting these data sets from various organizations and putting them together. I'm going to pass it over to Tracy.
Hi, great. Can everyone hear me?
Yeah, you sound good.
Great. So I think about infinite data integration. So as Greg said, one of our major goals is to acquire and synthesize existing data sets to create a seamless database of important landscape indicators. And using this database, we want to create a baseline here from which we can measure important changes and trends on the landscape and also monitor any kind of land management decisions that we take. This baseline year will be updated every 5 years. Our first step in this was a data mining exercise in 2010, and the report of this exercise is shown here. We summarized important landscape indicators that were identified in a workshop in 2009, and these were considered to be roads, road use, human structures and human use, rivers and riparian habitat, species composition, vegetation structure, and net primary productivity, forest and non-forest. And from this, we identified absolutely essential data sets to be our roads, railroads, and trails, our census statistics, streams and hydrology, land cover, and crown closure. So we went ahead and investigated all the various sources of data and organized these into various themes. The important themes that we identified are anthropogenic, geo-administration, imagery, hydrology, land features, and natural disturbances. We compile all of this information into a spreadsheet. And what I have here is just one small extract of the spreadsheet that was shown in the data mining report. And you can see that the information is organized by theme on the left and also by region. So the top is here, the United States. And then we have information, the type of data, the source date, the description, the spatial resolution, update frequency, etc. So this we have a huge spreadsheet. This is really just one page from that exercise. From that, we acquired as many data sets as we could, but only some of them were complete enough so that we could actually synthesize a complete baseline data set. And over here, these are the baseline data sets that we've managed to compile so far, and I'll show you actual examples of those shortly. However, imagine we don't have complete or consistent information for all of our key products for the entire region. For example, crown closure, unfortunately, we don't have a wall-to-wall coverage for Canada. Timber harvest data, which is really important land use information, particularly for grizzly bears, for example, was also not complete. We're still looking for a complete high-resolution imagery. Land use data as well, and impervious surface layer for Canada. So for this data set that was identified, what was the roads layer? So as Greg mentioned earlier, we actually have many possible data sets that we can combine to create a single roads layer. However, as you can see here, these different combinations, depending on which data sets you choose, can look quite different. So we went through a detailed exercise where we evaluated each of these different sources in terms of their spatial and attribute accuracy, consistency, and completeness. And from that, we took the best data sets and compiled those. And this is the result of that exercise. We used data from the Government of Alberta Sustainable Resource Development Department, the Digital Road Atlas of BC. And for Montana, we actually put together two data sets. For the forested regions and the national parks, we used the USDA Forest Service Region 1 roads. And for Indian reserves and other areas, the Montana Transportation Framework. These data sets together give us a number of attributes, such as road class, system, road width, a number of lanes. Unfortunately, they're not complete for across the entire region, but together we can use this information to actually establish road use, which was our other second very important indicator. So here's an example of our compiled census. Here we have on the left population density and dwelling density, and that's summarized per dissemination area. We also compiled streams and riparian habitats for the entire region. What's shown here is also stream and road crossings as well as watersheds. We compiled a number of phenological data sets. We derived this from the freely available data. We downloaded three products from MODIS, the land cover dynamics product at 1 kilometer squared and 500 meters squared, as well as the annual net farming productivity. The first two data sets here indicate the timing of particular phenological events, such as months of first green up, and that's what we actually have shown on the map right here. And annual net primary productivity gives us the total vegetation growth for the year. Other important data sets that were identified were natural disturbance, as you know, insects are very important at this stage, as well as fire history. And then finally, our land cover data set. I'm going to focus on this one as an example of the takes to really integrate multiple data sets. This one was quite complicated because we had a multiple sources of information. So for Montana, we had the National Land Cover Database 2001, which was fairly straightforward. But for Canada, we had two data sets, the Agricultural and Agri-Food Canada Land Cover Products and the Canadian Forest Service Land Cover Products. These two land cover data sets focus on different aspects. So as you can imagine, Agri-Food focused on agricultural lands and the Canadian Forest Service on forestry land. So we had to combine these two data sets to make the most of their strengths and to try and remove their weaknesses. As you can see here, there is actually quite a lot of inconsistency between the Canadian and the U.S. land cover. So here in the north, more than half of this image is the Canadian forestry land cover data set, and the gray indicates barren land. The southern half of this image, we see, which is the NLCD, we see a lot more scrub and shrub, which is this beige color. So this inconsistency, we managed to partially mitigate by replacing barren lands with information from the agricultural land cover data set. So this is a classification scheme, which is highlighted in green here. So it's a fairly simple land cover legend, but it's the only way we can make sure it's consistent and has the most important features, such as forest types, agriculture developed, etc. And what we had to do with the rock and rubble from the Canadian forestry data set is look at what the underlying agricultural land cover data set provided. And if it said it was shrubland, then we converted to shrubland. So we didn't simply paste together the two Canadian data sets. We looked at each individual combination of land cover classes to reclassify to the final classification scheme. And we also had to do a little bit of visual classification to correct here and there the barren land classes. So as you can see, here's an extract along the border with Canada in the north and Montana in the south, and you can see it's quite consistent. Barren lands are in this reddish brown and shrub and scrub and yellow, but it's certainly a lot better than it was. One way that we wish to further improve this product is transforming from a raster data set into a more generalized and polygon layer of the land cover, and we believe that by doing this, we can remove a lot of the noise and incorrect classification, improve the overall quality of the product. We also believe that the polygon is a better unit of analysis at this crown of the continent scale rather than individual pixels. And our colleague Guillermo Castillo, who's here, he has been working on a project in Alberta which works at generalizing the Alberta land cover product into a great generalized polygon layer, and he is going to give to you about that and provide more details of his methodology. So I'll be handing over to Guillermo. Thank you.
My name is Guillermo Castilla, and I'm an adjunct professor of the Department of Geography and the University of Calgary. I work with Greg McDermid in different projects that has some relation to this CMP project, and I'm going to tell you what we are doing in the other project regarding land cover mapping. So as Tracy said, we want to to generalize the land cover data set available in Alberta, which are mainly raster. We want to convert them into polygons. So we have, for example, this EOST raster that is the one that she referred before that has been produced by the Canadian Forest Service. This is a land cover, a huge land cover data set similar to the American NLED that was produced for the entire, for most of the forested area of Canada, and is based on unsupervised classification of Landsat imagery. And so first you create the spectral classes based on the Landsat imagery. Then you assign these spectral classes to mass classes. So this was done on a scene-per-scene basis for the entire forested area of Canada. So we have that, and we are going to use that information to create our baseline that is for the reference year of 2000. We're going to do it for the entire third. So what we do is, one could think that this raster to polygon conversion is a straightforward process, and actually could be if you would not be interested in generalizing a little the final product, but we want to get polygons that make sense. You do a direct raster vector conversion, you could end up with polygons that consist of single pixel or polygons that do not make a lot of sense. For example, this area that I'm marking now with a pointer is an area where you have a mix of broadleaf and conifer forest. The dark green is conifer. The light green is broadleaf. So, you see that there is a pixel by pixel intermixing of the two classes. Therefore, this area will be better characterized as a mixed forest. However, to do that using a conventional raster version is not possible. So, we had to add additional rules and additional methods to be able to achieve that. So, this is what we did. What we do is basically we go back to the original Landsat image that was used to produce the raster land cover map. We do a morphological cementation that ends up creating a very fine partition of that image. Then we apply a series of rules to each of these segments in order to assign a land cover class to each of the segments depending on the distribution of classes within the segment and the distribution of classes of a neighboring segment. So based on that, you obtain a preliminary polygon map. Then we remove regions that are smaller than minimum size, in our case, with stars, around 5 acres. That will be the outcome of removing that regions, and finally we convert that to a S3 shapefile and polygon. That will be the outcome, and as you can see again in that area that I showed before, the outcome of the generalization process is that we have managed to correctly identify that area as a mixed forest, and this is a great advantage of the process. So once we have our baseline for this reference year 1000, we want to update it to a series of other periods. So we plan to do that in a 5-year period. So basically, we had to collect imagery for the next period, detect changes between the two dates, and integrate these detected changes into the baseline. And I'm going to show you an example of that has been done using the automatic change detection tool that we have in-house and a framework for integrating change, this kind of baseline monitoring that was developed by Greg and another colleague. So here's an example. map, look at 2000, and then how it looks like. So this is the Landsat image that was used to derive that map. And here is the same area 5 years later as seen by Landsat. So go back one more time, and you can see that there's been a lot of forestry activity. Basically, all these pinkish areas are cut block. So what we do basically is with this tool, we detect there's been a significant change, and we then, once we have these polygons representing regions of change, we integrate them to the 2000 map as to obtain an updated version of the land cover map that will be the 2005 vision, say, of the map. So there is another app aspect that is involved in this, and that goes back again to the 2000 map, which is how reliable are the maps. So usually when you talk about accuracy assessment of remote sensing land cover maps, you usually use something that is called the confusion matrix. That is basically is a table where you show the agreement between a series of calls or assignments of a set of locations where you have information according to the map, according to your reference. That is usually either derived from ground visits or from higher resolution matrix. Problem is traditionally all remote sensing land core maps have been in cluster format. So we move away from that towards polygon maps. There are other aspects that had to be included in the accuracy assessment. And this aspect can be translated basically to three questions. So imagine that we were flying in a helicopter over the area that we have mapped. Then what we basically want to know is, if we were flying that helicopter over any given polygon, what is the probability that we would agree that the land cover class that appears in the map is the right one, or that when we see the polygon from the helicopter, we would not see any missing parts to the polygon or parts that had wrongly been included in it. Or when we see the boundaries in that land cover patch and the neighbors, we can agree that the polygon outline is placed on the right on the boundary. So this, obviously, to answer this question, requires more than preparing the conventional fusion matrix. So we have developed a method to tackle and try to give quantitative answers to those questions. And we are actually now testing of that method. So here's an example, basically. I hope that you can see the outlines on the left of the image. So this is an area from the current land cover map, and this is kind of a wetland that has been in the map appears as two separate units. Then the southern part of the unit has not been properly delineated. So basically, we select a series of validation polygons or reference polygons, then we redelineate the outline as we think it should be. Then we assign, based on the new delineation, we will assign whether there are missing parts or whether the boundary is well or misplaced, and whether or not the label for the entire area is the right one. So doing this for a set of validation polygons, we will be able to derive quantitative answers to the question I mentioned before. And this is the example of, again, a different project that Greg McDermid is evolving, and that hopefully will contribute also to the CMP. Now I'm handing over the up to the next speaker, Laura.
Hey, Laura, if you could make sure your phone is unmuted so we could hear you.
Sorry about that. Okay. So, my name is Laura O'Gann, and I'm pleased to talk with you today about data management of our project. So we chose to manage our data and supporting documents on the network-attached storage hosted by the University of Calgary. And this decision was made because the NAS offers a few user-friendly ways to read and download our data. And because it's hosted behind the University of Calgary firewall, it's very secure and backed up. And we also have a need to manage multiple permission levels. So our group can work with the source data while our partners only access specific final data sets. So why can't we all work with source data? Data sources on the U.S. side of the border were freely available for download, yet the same themes on the Canadian side of the border needed a written undertaking before permission to download the data was granted. So what does this mean to you? Many of our final synthesized data sets are restricted to be used for only the Crown Managers Partnership. Third parties may only acquire the data if they're providing services to the Crown Managers Partnership, and they must also sign a written agreement. So a key issue that needs to be resolved is the limitation on distribution of value-added products. And in addition, because the Canadian government acquires its data from multiple sources, different data restrictions apply to different data sets. So we're currently working with all the various sources of data to come to a common understanding of how our products will be viewed and utilized. What is on the NAS? We have basic documents, including map images of our final products. And in those documents, we also have our final report document, which we have two at this time. The first one is our data review report, which outlines sources and processing steps and status of our baseline data set. The second report is our MP8 products report, and this outlines analysis metrics and deliverables that are available to us to the Washington Office of the National Park Service. And MPscape is a mechanism for a unified approach at monitoring landscape dynamics with the intention of providing a broad brush insight into the landscape. And if you would like a more comprehensive inventory of all of the documents that we're serving on the NAS, please contact me and I'll be happy to talk with you about it more in detail. So in addition to documents, we also have our final synthesized data organized by the themes that Tracy introduced you to. And because of our intricate data sharing issues, all users must sign a written data agreement with our work group to access these data. In addition, a second agreement may be needed for access to the data which have elevated restrictions. And even with that second agreement, the distribution of these products will be subject to approval from the original data sources. And specifically, the data sets with elevated restrictions are the roads, census data, stream road crossing, and insect infestation history. So once you obtain the permission to access our final products, you'll be able to view and download geodatabases, the associated metadata, associated flat file tables, map images, and also a GIS map that can be opened in ArcGIS. So how do you get access? Email me, and I will send you the appropriate data sharing agreement. And once I have that signed, I will send you a login and password for the NAS, as well as a PDF, which will go over in detail three of the following connection methods. The one, you can connect through a web browser, and this is great for viewing the documents, the map images. And you might want to use an FTP if downloading large data sets. And the Windows Network Share is for users that are in partnership with the Crown Managers, and they will be able to view the NAS as a drive in Windows Explorer. And, of course, if you have any questions or comments questions about the NAS or its contents, feel free to contact me by phone or email. And with that, I'm going to hand it back over to Erin.
Okay, so I'm just going to wrap this up pretty quickly here and open it up to questions. Thanks so much to Laura and Guillermo and Greg and Tracy for going through really the meat of our work. Just in summary here, and next steps, as I presented at the beginning, we're basically going to continue to work on all the different aspects of the project that you saw presented here today. So completing the work on our baseline map and moving forward with the trend analysis, and then working on the aspects of the project that will solve problems with data error and propagation of data error, and how you resolve, remote sensing, remotely sensed landscape data with what you're actually seeing on the ground at the scale of the crown of the continent ecosystem. And then ultimately, we'd like to be able to share this data and share what we've learned and look at ways to collaborate with other people working in and outside of the region and really explore ways of how our data can be useful to other projects that are taking place in the region, such as, as Greg sort of outlined, grizzly bears and looking at habitat and connectivity analysis at the scale of the crown for those large species that we have and other transboundary species. And then phase three is really going at the same pace as we make these information products available in phase two. We want to get them to the managers in a timely fashion so that they can have sound data and knowledge products to be able to cumulatively make decisions at the scale of the crown of the continent. So with that, my screen's not moving here. There we go. So just quickly, I'd like to acknowledge all of our partners in this work. Of course, Great Northern Landscape Conservation Cooperative, all of our partnering agencies within the Crown Managers Partnership, the University of Montana, University of Calgary, the Alberta Biodiversity Monitoring Institute, and the National Park Service Rocky Mountain Inventory and Monitoring Network. And with that, and I'd also like to acknowledge everybody who joined us on the call and sat through this today. With that, I will open this up to questions.
Thank you very much, Erin. Again, if people have questions, please use the questions tool. We have a couple that have popped up, so I'm going to go ahead and start reading those off. The first one is from Jen Watkins, and this is for Tracy. I'm very interested in the scale of the data that was made available and the challenges that you may have run into. In Washington, we have worked with BC on coarse scale data, but the ability to get a finer scale has been a challenge. Thank you.
So can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. I think you said you wanted to work with fine-scale analysis. I think for us, we're trying to get the best available data, but we may actually, in fact, work at a coarser scale. So, like our land cover product was at 30 meters, but we aim to sort of generalize it to a polygon unit of analysis, which we feel is more appropriate for the entire crown of the continent tail that we're looking at. So it's not necessarily very local site analysis. Say some of the grizzly bear guys are doing very fine scale. This is exactly where we're going to have build a bridge across the road. It's not really the scale we're looking at. It's a step above that at the regional context. So some of our data sets are very fine scale, the roads, for example, but we're actually working at a coarser scale. And I guess most of our data sets are fine for that, except for maybe the MODIS products, which are obviously much coarser. I don't know if Greg has anything that he wants to add to that.
I'm not sure that I'm sort of sharing a phone here, and I didn't catch the question very clearly. I wonder, Deanna, do you mind repeating the question for me?
Well, unfortunately, the question went away. Maybe Tracy can repeat
it. I have nothing to add.
Sorry about that.
Yeah, I'm not sure I understood the question entirely, but it was one of the challenges we faced at integrating data at the scale and in the Washington Landscapes Project, I think it was Washington, how they had problems of going to a smaller, finer scale from maybe the coarser scale stuff they have.
Yeah, I sat in on the Washington Connected Landscape webinar, and perhaps the questioner came from one of those researchers. I'm not sure. It is a huge challenge, and I agree with everything Tracy has said. Although I would probably say that, you know, I wouldn't want to characterize our data as too coarse scale. I mean, we are still dealing with the best available data that we can get at most points. Mm-hmm. What we try and do, though, is we try and present it at a more appropriate spatial entity. And so the challenges we face, I mean, there's two of them. I mean, there are the technical challenges, you know, just making it all work, you know, from a technical perspective. And these are things that we can largely handle with tools and processing strategies and whatnot. And then there are the sort of the data sharing challenges, which I feel a little less well equipped to deal with, but we're fortunate with being part of the Crown Managers Partnership. I mean, many of our colleagues, you know, have access to, you know, the policymakers who make these data sharing agreements. So again, I'm not clear with the questioner whether they were talking about technical challenges or more administrative challenges. They're both there, and we're working on it on both fronts.
Okay, great, thank you. This next question is from Eric Beaver. Eric states, perhaps I'm misunderstanding what I've heard in a couple of different times in the talk, but it sounds like each new measurement becomes the new baseline rather than considering it simply as another assessment of status, as one member of a longer-term time series of information, i.e. trend analysis seems more meaningful if you look across all of the products or data points rather than simply looking back to the most recent baseline. And I think that that's more of a maybe a statement than a question, but if anyone would want to respond to that.
Sure, I can try. Again, it'd be better if we could be a little more interactive here so I could be clear on the comment. But it strikes me that instead of looking at snapshots in time, perhaps the questioner is wondering whether, you know, a longer time series might make for a more meaningful analysis, and I agree wholeheartedly. I think our strategy is that as time goes by, we will put together a time series, but we put that time series together sort of one step at a time. Another comment I'll make is that you sort of have choices when you're doing this time series analysis, at least when you're dealing with information products rather than data products. And that is, for example, if I use the land cover example, you could choose to classify things independently across different dates and look for changes from the classified products. That's not the way we're doing it. Our strategy is to, as you said, create a baseline map and then update it. The reason for that is more of a technical reason, and that is that we find that when you classify maps independently across different periods of time, then you have differential errors in those maps. And so when you're doing your time series analysis, you don't know whether changes are caused by differential errors or whether they're caused by real changes on the ground. So our experience is that the baseline update strategy is more effective for looking at changes in events than doing independent classifications. But I want to be clear that we do intend this to not just be a to-date sort of analysis. As time goes by, we will have a real time series that is a true monitoring framework across more than just one or two dates.
Great. Thank you, Greg. Next question is from Pei-Lin Yu. Do any of the presenters have thoughts about applicability of this approach towards cultural landscapes? Has there been any applicable work done in the CMP?
Any what type of work was that, Susanna?
Any applicable work done in the CMP?
Oh. Well, I can answer from the CMP perspective, and then I turn to Greg or Tracy as far as, applying these techniques to a cultural analysis. And the Crown Managers Partnership does not have culture or culture as one of our indicators, or traditional knowledge as one of our indicators in the ecological health project. And to this point, we certainly would be interested in adding that, but strongly that we need with the First Nations and tribes around.
I think we've lost Erin. Can any of the other speakers hear me? Hello? Can any of the other speakers hear me?